Hi everyone, how you doing? Happy Monday. Would you believe it? The winds just kicked up. I had everything set up outside and everything just kicked up. So hopefully we don't get blown around too much today. Hang on a second here while I refresh my computer. So today is all about composting. It's gonna be a fun one. Composting is such a great way to get free fertilizer for your garden. You can compost in a small space, you can compost in a large space. There's all kinds of different ways that you can compost, different types of containers, different types of piles. Woo, we're getting blown around here. So we're gonna cover a lot of tips today. Is it buffering? Okay, let me just check my connection. I think we're good on the hotspot, but it could be, due to the wind. So I'm gonna try and hang on to my tripod just a little bit and see how things go. Of course, it's supposed to be windy all week long, but today was supposed to be a calm day, but I guess not so much here at noon Pacific time. So anyway, it's actually gonna be a warm week. The winds that are blowing in are warm winds. They're called the Santa Ana winds. If you live in Southern California, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And it's supposed to be windy, I think, for the rest of the week and heated up into the 80s. Believe it or not. So we are enjoying the warm weather, but not the wind, because it dries the plants out and it just makes getting outside really difficult. Anything new I put into the garden, it just pretty much dries the leaves to a crisp. But for today, here we are. We're gonna have a great time, no matter if I get blown away or not. So sorry if there's any buffering or anything like that going on. So let me just say hello to those of you that are here in the chat. We have Wendy here from Windy Rancho Cucamonga. Yeah, I've heard it's really windy down your way. So hopefully you hang in there. We have Santa Ana Road Wildman. He's not often able to join us on Mondays because he's working. He's off today, he's here, he's up in Central California. Precious SoCal Gardener, not buffering for me. Good, I'm so glad. Terry, I believe Terry, you're also from SoCal too, right? So welcome to all you SoCal people, and hopefully you don't get blown away this week in our crazy, crazy winds. Okay, Pony Girl, hi from sunny, windy 7 degrees in the low desert of Arizona. So it sounds like there's wind all over the place. I know the East Coast, I don't know if you guys are still in that terrible, terrible cold snap that was going on a couple of weeks ago. I know Texas had some rough cold weather. Cliff in Idaho and Nisha in Colorado, there are moderators have been going through a lot of cold weather and snow as well. So hopefully things kind of even out a little bit. But the good news is, you guys, the spring countdown is on. It's just 41 days till spring. So we're all gonna be celebrating that spring weather in about 41 days. Hopefully the spring weather hits at the same time the actual day, first day of spring hit. So welcome. So glad that you all are here. And we are just diving right into spring gardening. Hopefully a lot of you are watching our First Time Gardener series. Those are especially geared to people who are brand new first time gardeners. We've done how to set up simple grow lights, how to make your own seed starting mix. Yesterday we did, Saturday, we did how to start tomato and pepper seeds and avoiding very critical timing mistakes. So if you haven't watched those videos yet, it's not too late to jump in. Head over and watch those. And we're starting a little bit early this year to give people time to get started, to give people time to gather together their supplies, and because we're gonna be doing some fun new content on raised beds. So we wanted to get the indoor seed starting going, and that way we can do our raised beds, as the couple of months or as the time goes on here. So welcome to all you first time live streamers. And you guys ready? Let's jump into our composting tips. We'll take questions in between the tips. And we just have a great time here. A lot of people have been live streaming with me now for 3 years or so and are getting to be fast friends. So welcome to all you first time live streamers as well. Okay, so let's jump right in. Composting might be intimidating if you've never done it before, but I promise you it's not as difficult as you think. Sometimes the hardest part is getting started, and I like to keep things very simple. We're talking about very basic composting today. And you don't have, it does not have to be complicated. So there's just a couple of kind of basics that let's get out of the way. First of all, there's a couple of different types of piles that you can have when you're talking about composting. And I think most people are familiar with what compost is. It's basically just broken down organic matter that you can make for your garden. It's free, which is awesome. You're using scraps around your kitchen, scraps from your garden, all kinds of different ingredients, which we'll get into in just a moment. But basically, it's just black gold is what we gardeners like to call it. And I'll show you some finished compost in just a moment. But it's a method of taking things that you would normally throw away and layering it in such a way that it breaks down over time and you're making free fertilizer for your garden. So you really can't beat it. So the first thing is to be aware of that there are different types of compost piles. So you can hot compost, which is one way to do it. And basically what that is the microbes, the microbial activity in the compost, the little teeny tiny microbes basically heat up the compost. They're basically digesting all the compost materials that you have in your pile. And it's a method of composting where it gets hot and then the materials break down very, very quickly. So that's the big, huge benefit of hot composting is the materials can break down in about a month or so. Now, the drawback to hot composting is you need a lot of materials to make your hot compost pile. Usually for a hot compost pile, you want the bigger, the better. So I like to get mine about a 3x3 size, so about 3 feet tall by 3 feet wide. To me, that's a really good size to where it heats it up and it helps just cook it out from the inside out, and then the materials break down super fast. So it could be difficult if you do have a small space. And again, we're talking composting for big spaces and for small spaces. I don't know if I mentioned that earlier in the live stream, but no matter how much space you have, you can compost. It just might be a different type of a pile. So again, hot composting, need a big pile. For example, right here, if this blew all around, I've got a couple different compost sacks right behind me. Smart Pots makes a great compost sack, which is really helpful for keeping your compost all contained in one area. So this one right here, actually meant to uncover it, but it got windy, so I covered it back up. This one, this brick is really heavy. Right behind me, I had to do that. Woo, my water just dumped over. I had to do that because I didn't want the cover blowing away. But this one here is a 100-gallon Smart Pots compost sack, and I actually have it filled right now with leaves because I'm composting in the smaller one, which I'll talk about in just a moment. But this is a 100-gallon size. Let me see if you guys, if I can tip this down, you guys can see the size of it a little bit better. It's a 100-gallon size, and I actually have it folded over by about a third. But it's a great size for a hot compost pile. I've made several hot compost piles, and this one, it works very, very well. And we'll talk about the materials in just a moment. I'm going to cover it back up so it doesn't get blown away. Okay. But anyway, that works great. I've got, I've got several videos on hot composting. So, all the links for the videos I mentioned today will be in the video description. But the key for that is just collecting enough ingredients to fill it all at once so you can make a big, huge compost pile. And we are going to talk about composting in the winter time too, for those of you that are frozen. I just saw a question scroll by about that. So the other way I've been composting lately is also in this little Smart Pots mini compost sack. Little side note on this. This one, you guys might have seen my Instagram post last week. This one is a 50-gallon size, which I really feel like is a lot more manageable for a backyard gardener or someone that's, you know, doesn't have such a big space. And a lot of you gave that feedback that you really do like the smaller size. Smart Pots is actually putting the finishing touches on this 50-gallon mini compost sack. I'm actually just testing it out for them right now. So let me know in the chat or in the comments of the replay, if you're watching the replay, if you would enjoy the 100-gallon size better, or hopefully they'll be coming out with a new compost mini in the summertime. So they've asked me to gather together some feedback if that's something people would like. Right now I have it in the black, but they're also considering making it in the forest green. So let me know what color you like the best. And they're also considering, which I love this, adding handles. I think that would be so, so handy because you can move it around your yard. If you're on a patio or a balcony, that would just make it super handy. And they're also considering adding a cover. So please let me know in the chat or in the comments of the replay what you think about that, and give me your feedback, and I will definitely pass it on to Smart Pots. And one reason why I love working with Smart Pots so much is they do really listen to people's comments and try and make their products better so that it better fits what the home gardener actually does. So they really do love and appreciate your feedback. And I'm seeing a lot of comments fly by in the chat. Handles would be great. Santa Ana Road Wildman, I think that would be awesome to have handles. So yeah, thank you so much for that feedback. And they are offering a discount code for Calichem viewers, 10% over at smartpots.com with the code Calichem. So go over if you want a compost sack and grab that with that code. So we've got a large pile, which will be hot composting. Now the other type of compost pile that you can make is a cold compost pile. And that's a lot more doable for people who are composting in a small space because you don't need near as many materials. So that's basically where you're just throwing the materials in and you're just kind of letting them break down over time. You want to, you know, keep the materials moist. You want to turn it, you know, once a week or so, but you're not too worried about speeding things up. And I've got several videos on cold composting. You can cold compost in a very small container. You can do it in a 50-gallon if you want to, but I've made it myself many a time. Let me just show you this little 5-gallon here, in a 5-gallon container. And it does take a little bit of time to break down, but you can definitely speed this process up by making sure that you have super small materials once you put them into your compost. So you can go back and watch my video on composting in a small 5-gallon container. It definitely does work, but the key is really getting the materials broken down very small. I just put them in a blender, and that way the smaller, the better when you start. So the two different types of piles to start out, keeping it simple, hot compost pile, cold compost pile. There's a zillion different things that you can put your compost in. Either the compost sacks, which are really nice because they're all self-contained with the cover. They keep the critters out, which I really like. We've got a lot of squirrels and critters here in our garden. So, and also the thing about the compost sacks is, the fabric is, hang on a second, I've got some things blown away here. The fabric is aerated. So that way the air gets in more to your compost pile, which will help it break down that much quicker. And we're going to talk about air and water, which are two very important parts of composting in just a moment as well. Okay, so first tip, know which type of compost pile you want to have in your garden, what you have space for, a hot compost pile or a small, or a hot compost pile or a cold compost pile. And thank you guys so much for all, yes, keeps the dog out too. Thank you so much for all of your feedback. Yeah, I think I'm gonna get blown away. I seriously, guys, when I set this up this morning, it was so stinking calm out here. So I thought that, hey, we're gonna be fine to go outside. But you know what? I'm fine. I'm not gonna blow away and we're gonna have fun out in the garden. I really enjoy much more live streaming outside because I just think it brings, you know, the garden to life. I can have little, you know, examples like this right behind me here, and it's really a lot more fun than streaming inside. That's just not that much fun. But you know what? We deal with the elements, and it's all part of live video. It's all the fun of live video. Okay, let's head into the chat here and see what's going on. Wendy, a 50-gallon with a lid, handles would work best. Yeah, I totally, oh yeah, look at my hair here too. I love the 50-gallon. Honestly, I've been trying it out for about a month, and I absolutely love it. It's just so much more manageable to turn, to water, all that kind of stuff. So thank you so much for that feedback. And the lid, yes, definitely. Can't you just compost in a plastic garbage can? Absolutely, Marilyn. You know what? You can compost in just about anything you want to, or you can just have like a freestanding pile. And I have a video on different types of piles that you can build, different ways to build piles, whether it's in a compost sack or whether it's in like a little pile with a little, you know, bit of fencing around it. There's all kinds of videos I have. I do have a full compost playlist, and I don't even know how many videos there are on there. There's several on there on different types of piles you can build, as well as a compilation video of a lot of my compost videos all put together on basically how to compost A to Z. So tons of resources on our YouTube channel as far as composting goes. So do make sure you check those out too for more details. And my backyard gourds, love it. I'm using those storage containers for my compost. Great to do that too. One thing that's helpful when you are using a container, like a trash can or a storage bin or something like that, is drill some holes in it. So that the compost pile gets aerated, so that the water drains out and things don't just sit there. And good. Connie, you were reading my mind. So the compost materials don't like get moldy or smell or anything like that. So do make sure if you're using a big trash can or a container to drill some holes in it. Now, one thing that works really well too is this container right behind me here is one of my brand new 10-gallon Calichem Smart Pots. That's a great size for composting in a small space as well. If you can move it up just a little bit from the 5-gallon to the 10-gallon, that would be great too. And Cool Mom collected, can you compost in a 5-gallon bucket inside your home? If it's frigid outside, that's what the kids and I are currently doing. Absolutely. You know what, guys, just adjust it, make it work for your situation. And I love that. Cold outside, so you're composting indoors, and it's a great lesson to learn with your kids. Way to go, Mom. Teaching your kids like a little science project at the same time, definitely. You will want to make sure that you know, you're not having a lot of water sitting around. Don't overwater your compost. We're going to talk about how to know when your compost is done, and also water and air for your compost in just a moment. So hang on to that too. That also brings up a good point, is that you can compost in the winter outside. Now, it's not going to break down real quickly outside, but if your ground is frozen, like here in California, obviously, you know, we don't get a frost or frozen ground, so we can compost outside year round. But if you're in a cold climate and your ground is frozen solid, definitely still continue building up your compost. Now is a great time to start collecting materials, because what happens is, even if it freezes, the process of freezing, thawing will help break down your compost that much quicker. And that way, when spring hits, you're already been collecting materials and you're one jump ahead. As the weather heats up, you know, your compost will begin breaking down a little bit faster. But definitely, if you don't have anywhere else to put those scraps and you want to compost in the wintertime and it's cold and frozen, go ahead and throw them outside in your compost pile. Now for me, what I do is I keep a little bucket. You know what, let's hold off on that. I'm gonna get into that in the next little tip. There is just so many fun things to talk about compost. And I usually get really excited about it because I love to compost. But it's just a lot to cover in one live stream. So let me see if there's another couple little questions here before we move into our next tip. Nicole, yes, keeps the rabbits out if you have a cover. So definitely do, you know, if you're able to cover your compost, even this right now, I don't have a cover for it, but I've been keeping like a piece of plywood over it. Number one, the biggest thing for us right now is things blowing away. So that does keep my compost from blowing away and keeps it all in, but it also keeps the critters out. So if you can all cover your compost, that's, that much better too. So, okay, guys, we got to move on here. It's so much fun. We're going to move on into the second, tip here that I have. Oh, before I forget, I almost forgot yesterday that, and Jerry reminded me, it is, yesterday, you guys, was our 10-year anniversary on YouTube. So pretty exciting. I cannot believe that it's been 10 years that we have had our YouTube channel. The time has just flown by, and you guys are a big part of it. We are going to be doing some really fun things later in February to commemorate our 10-year YouTube anniversary. So definitely stay tuned for that. We have a special video planned. We're gonna be doing a hose link giveaway on that video. So you will not want to miss that. That should be coming up in, I believe, 2 weekends. So definitely stay tuned for that. It's gonna be a very special one, and we're gonna have a ton of fun with it. Some really special things planned for that video. That camera guy has been kind of keeping under his hat. So you don't want to miss it. Put that on your calendar. I think that video is going to be coming out on Saturday the 20th, I believe is the day. So stay tuned for it, guys. Thank you so much for all your congratulations, and we wouldn't be here without you all. So it's super exciting that that's coming up. Can you believe it? 10 years. So yeah, it's pretty crazy. So anyway, just wanted to mention that real quick before I forgot. And let's move on here. Woo! See, my camera's blowing around too. Let's move on here to the second thing about composting, and that is, keeping it simple here, guys, is start gathering together your ingredients. It is not too soon to start doing that, even if you're in the cold winter, like I mentioned. But there's two different types of ingredients that you want to gather for your compost: the browns and the greens. Now, brown and green does not necessarily refer to the color of the materials. That's a number one probably misconception. But your browns are your carbon source. So that's gonna be the thing that feeds the microbes. So those are things like newspapers, like leaves. That's one reason why I collect so many leaves, is because I love to make compost with them as well as mulch my garden. but I'm always having, you know, my neighbors save their leaves for me. I give them a couple of my green bins to fill up all the time, or even I put a compost sack over there. My neighbor has tons of trees and say, hey, can you fill up my compost sack when you collect your leaves? So right now I've got this 100-gallon one full and a couple other green little bins on the side of the house that are full as well. So collect your leaves, always save your leaves. Brown cardboard, newspaper, straw is a really good one too. Tree clippings, like if you have, you know, shredded branches or even shredded up wood chips that you've saved, maybe you've cut down trees in your yard, those types of things, twigs, any of that kind of thing. Sawdust is a good one. If you're like building something, you can put sawdust in there. That's a good brown material. You do want to avoid shiny newspaper, like the ads that come like in the Sunday paper that are kind of the slick ads that have a lot of color printing on them, or like the shiny cardboard, maybe that has, I always peel like all the stickers off of it first, but that shiny cardboard that maybe you buy something in from, I don't know, Best Buy or something like that, that I don't generally use, but you can use like shredded brown cardboard boxes from like that you get on Amazon. Those are good for compost. But I usually do peel off all the stickers and things like that. So yeah, those are the brown materials. That's the carbon source that feeds the microbes. Very important to have a good mix of browns and greens. I'll talk about the ratio in just a moment. Greens are, you need green material, and those are the nitrogen source. So those would be like your kitchen scraps, your plant-based kitchen scraps. When you are cutting up a cucumber and you have the end of the cucumber that you don't use, throw that into your little compost bucket under your kitchen, under your sink, which is what I do. I just save them all in a small little bucket until I'm ready to bring them outside. My hair is like totally in my face. Okay, let's see here. Where did that go? All right, coffee grounds are a great thing to say, are a great nitrogen source. Eggshells, I save all of my eggshells. Your garden clippings, like maybe you take down a tomato plant that might have, you're taking out for the season. As long as it's not diseased or bug infested, you can go ahead and use that in your compost. If you're trimming like your cucumber plants or your cabbage or your lettuce, maybe has dried up and it's you know, gone by the wayside or whatever, you're ready to start new lettuce. Those are all types of things that you can use for a green material in your compost. So what you want to avoid though, when it comes to the greens, is non-plant-based food scraps such as meat or dairy. So the main reason for that is they tend to attract the critters. So eventually it probably would break down. So I'm talking like meat, I'm talking like bread, milk products like cheese and things like that. I don't put those in my compost. But any of your plant-based food scraps from the kitchen, you can definitely put in your compost as well. Now, the general ratio between browns and greens is about three parts brown, so all those shredded leaves, about three parts brown, and about one part green. Now don't, yes, tea bags will work too, thank you. But don't get all caught up if you don't have exactly the right ratio. That's not the point here. The point is just to start collecting those materials and generally get a ratio of three parts brown to one part green, and then just go for it. You wanna put them in your compost sacks or your compost pile, kinda layer them, mix them up, and we're going to talk about the other two remaining ingredients that are very important for compost in just a moment. So to summarize here, we've got our different piles. Decide if you want a hot pile or a cold pile. Hot pile might be more well-versed for big spaces. Small pile or cold pile, better suited for smaller spaces. And then start collecting your browns and your greens to build your pile. Okay, we'll talk more about composting in just a moment. A couple more tips on that. But there's tons and tons of flying by in the chat. So let's see what's going on. And if you have any questions on composting for me here that I can answer, we will go for that before we move on to our next tip. Okay, Nicole, great question. What about composting in place, digging a hole near a plant and then burying your kitchen scraps? You know what? I've never actually I have done that before. I buried like fish scraps in a hole where I was planting a tomato. Haven't done it real often. That's definitely a good option. You definitely can do that. Composting in place, it keeps it really simple. If you have critters, you might want to kind of keep that in mind. They might be digging it up. So, you know, just experiment. It's always good to experiment and try different things, see what works. And if that works for you, then more power to it. That removes one of the steps that you would have to do by composting right in place. So maybe you want to try it a couple of different ways and then see which way you like best. Okay, let's see here. Coffee is high in nitrogen. Yes, if you're having coffee grounds, coffee is a nitrogen. Yes, it is confusing. Do go back and watch my videos because I explain all that in detail. But if you're having problems with your hot compost heating up, coffee grounds is absolutely like a surefire way to get it to heat up, but you need a lot of them. So a lot of coffee shops will give away their coffee grounds, their used coffee grounds for free. Starbucks, and maybe check with your local coffee shops if you have like some family-owned shops. A lot of times they just kind of need to get rid of them because they have a ton of them, and you can go in and ask them to save them for you. And adding a big old bag of Starbucks coffee grounds is like a surefire way to get a compost sack heated up in a hurry. So a really great way to do that. Okay, let's see, a couple more questions here, I think. Okay, yeah, that was fun when I buried the fish in that hole. You remember that too. That was pretty fun. That was a couple years back. So anyway, let's see what else here is going on. Yeah, great tip there about the coffee grounds. Okay, let's see, got Nicole's question here. Cardboard from Sam's where they divide water pallets is a great find. Yes. A lot of times you could go and ask grocery stores if they have cardboard boxes, although so many of us order from Amazon a lot now that I usually have tons of cardboard boxes that I'm adding to the recycled trash can, and there's usually plenty of cardboard around here. Even like the packing material that you might have in your boxes that you order online, that's thinner and you can break it up or shred it up. And the smaller that you can get your materials, the quicker it's going to break down. So that packing material or like eggshells are great to rip into pieces and throw into your compost pile as well. Okay, so let me see if I have any other announcements. I like to kind of pepper in announcements in between the tips. Oh yes, one great deal we have going on right now. A lot of you ordered this weekend and took advantage of this great deal is, a couple things going on here, is we have with every order this week over at CallieKimGardenHome.com, every order gets one of my free, one of my new seed collections for free. And I just launched 6 brand new seed collections. So the freebie of the week is the kale seed collection. Ta-da! This is brand new, just launched a couple of weeks ago. So any order, whether it's all 30 of my seed collections, my smart pots, signed copies of my book, Organic Gardening for Everyone, every order this week through, I believe it's through next Monday or through the 15th, will get a free kale seed collection. There's 4 varieties in here so you can get these planted in your garden. Kale is so easy to grow, and this is a really good deal. So the new collections are the kale collection, the zinnia collection. This one is selling out like crazy. The zinnia collection is super popular, one of my new ones. This one is probably the second most popular right now, the red pollinator flower collection. Gorgeous flowers in here. Red nasturtiums, absolutely beautiful. The onion seed collection, which we have an onion video coming up very soon, is one of my new ones. Specialty greens, delicious. Great for stir fries. 6 varieties of Asian greens in here. Not just Asian greens, but all kinds of specialty greens. And then, did I go through all 6? I think I did. I think there's one more, or maybe that was all 6 of them. But anyway, the spring garden seed collection and my new book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. If you buy the seed book bundle, it's $5 off. Plus you get a free kale seed collection. So it really is a good deal. And then you can save even more if you pre-order my new book, which a lot of you know, unfortunately it's been delayed by about a month. But if you pre-order my new book, you can get a $10 coupon for CallieKimGardenHome.com. And all the details are in the video description and also over at CallieKimGardenHome.com. Not only do you get a $10 coupon when you pre-order, but you also get a free download, an excerpt from my book, and it's one of my raised bed plans that's in here. It's a simple wood raised bed plan. So if you wanted to get your raised bed started and the book's been delayed, no worries, just pre-order and you'll get a free download of one of the raised bed plans in here so you can get started as soon as possible. So lots of new stuff. The 10 gallons are also new, the CallieKim 10 gallons. Lots of new stuff for spring. So hopefully you guys are jumping in, grabbing your seeds and getting your gardens planted. And we'll have more first-time gardener videos to help you with that coming up in the next couple of weeks. Okay, so we've talked about our hot and cold compost piles. We've talked about our brown and green ingredients. Again, keep it simple. Don't get too hung up on that. The next thing that you need to have for your compost pile, or that you need to do, really important ingredients as well in composting, are water and air. So once you've got your compost pile built, whether you're doing it in the 10-gallon, the little 5-gallon pot, or a trash can, or however you're doing it, the next thing your compost pile needs is air and water. So you want to water it down. You want to keep it moist. You don't want it dripping wet, because then it can get too soggy. You need it about the moistness of a wrung out sponge. So right here, I actually just watered down my compost pile this morning. It was getting really dried out. You want it to kind of, let me see if I can get this up here without getting stuff all over. You want it to kind of hold together a little bit when you go like this. So it probably could be just a little bit wetter. But you don't want it dripping wet. You just want to water it and then kind of turn your pile. Turning your pile will give it air. So for a hot compost pile, once it heats up, I like to get out there and turn it every day or every other day, just to get that air down in there, and then make sure it's not getting too dried out. Get my hose over there and spray it down. For a cold compost pile, like this little small one here, is I like to water it and check on it about once a week or so, turn it over. But the more you turn it, the quicker it's gonna break down. So, you know, it's really just one of those things. You don't have to do any watering and turning every day, but the more you do, the quicker it will break down. Now, sometimes I let my compost pile just kind of sit for a while. I forget about it and it gets super dried out, or maybe it rains and it helps moisten it, and then I get in there and turn it. So, you know what, no big deal. It just takes longer to break down. But the more that you turn it, the more you pay attention to it and make sure it has a good amount of moistness to it, a good amount of water to it, the better and quicker it will break down. So just kind of pay it a little bit of attention. But if you don't want to do that, no big deal. It eventually will break down over time. It just might take 3 to 6 to 12 months. So it's totally your choice. So we need our greens, we need our browns, we need our water, we need our air. That's it, guys. That's all you need to compost. Somewhere to put it, whether it be in a closed-in container like the smart pots, whether it be in a pile. I used to have a pile right over here, right next to me, and that's what I used. But then the compost sacks just, to me, like, help keep it nice and tidy, and I don't have, you know, food scraps like laying on the side of my yard. So I really started to go more towards those, and I really like them a lot. So let's see here if I wanted to mention anything about that. Oh yes, I do have a couple of videos on how to turn a compost pile in a compost sack, and videos about kind of how to water it down. So do go over and watch that compost playlist for more in detail demonstrations about how to do that. And that hopefully will clear up any confusion for you. Okay, next we're gonna talk about how many piles are optimal for your garden. So before we do that though, let's jump into the chat here and see what else is going on. Okay, let's see. Congratulations for Deborah. Thank you so much for joining us. Your first time live, thanks to the Rusted Garden. Yeah, he's doing his lives, I think, every couple of weeks, and we've got ours here on Monday. So glad that you're here. Thank you so much for the congrats. It's crazy to think it's been 10 years. It's gone so, so fast. And by the way, guys, a new podcast will be dropping this coming weekend, a new Gardening Coast to Coast podcast. So do make sure you look out for that. If you never listened to our podcast, I do it. Gary and I from the Rusted Garden are podcasting together. It's called the Gardening Coast to Coast, Gardening Coast, the number 2, and then Coast. And this upcoming one, we do talk about what to do in the garden in February. So check that out and give a listen to wherever you listen to podcasts, or head over to gardeningcoasttocoast.net and all the links will be over there. Okay, thank you so much, James. So glad you're enjoying the podcast. I got compost on my mind today. Let's see here. Any other questions? Hello, Backyard Farming with Ashley. Great to have you here today. Thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. My backyard gourds in the spring. I will go into the woods behind the barn and gather some leaves to add to my compost. Yeah, that's a great thing to do too. If you don't have trees in your garden or in your yard, head down to the local park, and there's usually more than enough. You can bring yourself a couple of black garbage bags or whatever, collect some leaves, and that way you can get some extra leaves, or ask your neighbors to save them, or anything else. There's always a way to collect leaves around. Okay, so how to use the compost. We're going to get into that in just a second, all right? First, before we get into that, is how many piles should you have? Okay, I'm just going to tell you what the optimal thing is, what I like to do with my compost, and then you can kind of adjust it to your space. But basically what I do, I feel like a good goal is to have three different piles, whether they be small, like this little 5-gallon sack, or whether they be large. This can be considered a compost pile. So what I like to do is have one pile where I'm just kind of collecting my scraps. And what I do here, I have like a 10-gallon 10-gallon smart pots right out here where I'm taking my kitchen scraps from inside. When I fill up my little bin inside under my sink, I bring them out here and I put them in my 10-gallon smart pots. And that's where I'm just kind of collecting my scraps. So that would be pile number one. Pile number two is for my my big pile here that I want to break down. I don't want to be adding brand new scraps to this pile because then it kind of has to start the breakdown process all over again. I'm watering this, I'm turning it on a regular basis. I want it to break down over the next couple of months so I have some beautiful black gold for my spring garden. So I'm not adding new scraps to this. So this is pile number two, is your compost that's kind of in process. Pile number three would be your compost that's finished. So I've got several of these 5-gallon little Calichem Smart Pots that are full of compost. So once it gets finished from my 50-gallon, I will start putting it into the 5 gallons, or I'll probably start using the 10 gallons because these are getting a little bit small. I might have too much compost. So I've got my finished compost. You can use 5-gallon buckets. You can use whatever you want, but just keep your finished compost, you know, in another spot or in your shed so it doesn't blow away or wherever, or in a 5-gallon bucket so you can carry it around your garden and use it in your garden. So it'll get taken out of this 50-gallon, and this is going to shrink down as the compost, as the microbes are, you know, chowing down on the good organic material. It will shrink down, and I can put it in several of my 10-gallon smart pots that I can use it in my garden, and then refill this one with the food scraps that I've been collecting in another spot. So that's just kind of what I like to do, is keep three piles going. Your materials collecting pile, your pile that's in process, and your pile that's finished. So hopefully that helps you kind of get organized a little bit with your compost. And that way you always have a supply of compost that you're working on in your garden. So I highly encourage you to get started composting. It's a great way to save money on fertilizer. It's really the perfect fertilizer for your garden. It's not going to burn your plants. It's a very low NPK, but it's like nature's best fertilizer. So if we could all have enough compost, we really wouldn't have to use much other types of fertilizer in our gardens. It's a really, really good way to be organic, be sustainable, and feed your garden for free. Now, before we get back in the chat, I'm going to cover my last tip here, and that is how to use it in your garden. So, and how do you know when it's finished? Now, this you can see still does have some little particles like eggshells and things like that, but you basically know when it's finished when you don't have any big chunks of food scraps. It really starts to look like soil. It smells nice and earthy. This smells absolutely delicious, if there is such a thing for soil. This one's pretty dry because it's been sitting around for a little while. But this one is finished compost, just a few eggshells left. So I'm going to kind of hold it up here, but you can see it's nice and fine. Some people like to sift their compost. To me, that's just one extra step. If you want to do that, great. I never do that. I just grab a handful. This is how you use it. I grab a handful. First off, when it comes time for spring planting, if I have enough, I will layer 2 to 3 inches on top of my garden beds. I don't usually have enough to do that to all of my garden beds. So a lot of times what I'll do is I'll just add a handful to the planting hole. And you can do that anytime throughout the season. When you plant and put your transplants out, you can put a little handful of compost right in the planting hole. Or once your transplants have been growing for a couple of months, once a month or so, you want to go around and add a little handful of compost just around the base of the plant. And then all you have to do is water it in so all those good nutrients soak down into the root. So it's super, super easy to use. I think the biggest thing about composting is that people tend to overcomplicate it. So just keep it simple, and it's going to be really fun when you make your very first compost and it breaks down, you're gonna be so proud of yourself because you're basically turning trash into treasure and you're able to have your own black garden gold that you're basically feeding your garden for free. So it's really a very satisfying feeling. And the cool thing is too, when you're building a big pile like this, it's actually a really good workout and I really like to have fun doing that. Okay, excuse me, hang on, let me get a sip of water before I blow away. Okay, so we've covered a lot of information today. I know I've been talking fast, but do go back and watch my videos on composting for more details. It's always a super popular topic. And I just saw a question go by. Lots of good questions going by. I'll answer as many as I can. Does the compost bin need to be in full sun? No, it doesn't. Pretty much in the wintertime, mine is in shade all the time. If it's in sun, it does help it to heat up quicker, but it does not have to be. So if you've got a sunny spot, great, but if not, go ahead and start composting. I saw another question, I believe it was Nisha, is can you compost citrus? There's lots of controversy about this. I compost citrus. I've never had an issue with it. People say don't do it, but we go through a lot of oranges, lemons, and limes. We really love those. We use the oranges in our smoothies and for fresh orange juice. So I have always composted citrus without an issue. So yes, you definitely can compost citrus. Okay, good compost often smells sweet. Yes, it does. It smells like fresh earth. Woo! This is really an adventure out here today. It smells like fresh earth. And go back and watch my videos for how to layer it. I basically just go through and layer it and then water it down and mix it up. So if you don't get the layers just right, it's really no big deal because you're mixing it up anyway. And then it all just starts breaking down. Okay, I saw a question here from Angela. How's it going, Angela? If starting in the spring with grass clippings and leaves, how long will it take a compost pile to be ready? How long for the pile to cook? Okay, if you've got a big enough pile to heat up, you've got a hot pile, and you're consistently turning it and watering it. I've had a pile in this large compost sack right here, the 100-gallon breakdown, in about a month. So, but you do have to make sure that it's cooking and heating up hot. I've got a compost thermometer that I check my compost with. And literally, when you dig into it, you can see steam coming out. You can go watch my video on that for more information. Can I start composting under my deck? I can't remember who asked that, but I saw it scroll by. And yes, you absolutely can. You can compost anywhere, as long as you can keep it from blowing away like it's doing today. But the cover on it really does help. Okay, let's see if we can get any more questions here in. Before Connie, great suggestion. If your compost container or bag isn't too big, flip it over and dump it, add some water, and then put it back in. It mixes well and gets a good dose of air throughout. Great suggestion. There's so many different ways to compost. So it's just kind of a matter of keeping it simple, doing what works for you. If you have a small space, do it in a small container. The 5-gallon works great. Watch my video on that. 10-gallon would be excellent for a little bit more compost. I love the aeration of the smart pots because it does help it break down quicker too. Okay, Cliff, great suggestion. If you have a big pile, stick a piece of rebar in it. Use it like a thermometer. When you pull it out, the rebar, I've done that many a time too, Cliff. You pull out the rebar and it feels warm. That means the center of your pile is getting hot. So that works really well as well. If you don't have a compost thermometer, just to see if it's heating up there. Okay, newbie composter D, great job. I encourage you just to dig right in. It is gonna be fun. We can share, composting tips together as we go throughout the springtime, and do make sure you give me feedback on the Smart Pots compost sack in the video, in the comments or in the chat. I will be sending those over to Smart Pots, and be looking on Instagram because I'm going to have some more compost tips coming up over there as well. So guys, this has been a ton of fun. I think I'm ready to head in now because I'm getting blown away. I'm having to hang on to my my tripod and my camera here. But let's see, it looks like Crystal asked a good question. Okay, can you compost oleander? Oh, that's a good question. I have never grown oleander, and I don't know about composting it. I've heard since it's poisonous, you should not compost it, but maybe that breaks down with compost and doesn't affect other plants. You know what, I would do some research on that. I'm not sure about that. So definitely do research. If anyone knows about that, if you could pop that in the chat, that would be great. There will be a Gardening Coast to Coast podcast on compost coming up probably in February or early March. So do be watching out for that as well. So what a fun live stream together today, guys. Sorry, I'm getting blown away, but it's the beauty and the fun of live video. I mean, you really can't go wrong with that. So do stay tuned for our video this weekend. I believe we're going to be doing either onions or maybe starting cucumbers and watermelons. So definitely stay tuned. I think I'm leaning more towards the onion video. We've had lots of requests for onion videos, but yeah, what a fun live stream. Do make sure you take advantage of my free kale seed collection this week, and don't forget your $10 free on me when you pre-order my book. All the info is in the video description over at calikimgardenhome.com. What a fun live stream. Thanks for joining me, and we look forward to seeing you on next Monday's live stream. All right, guys. Bye-bye. Have a great, fantastic week.